okay. Trust me, you're not missing. That was the first slide. Okay. Routes of medication administration, we have several different ones that we're about to talk about. So the GI route, okay, this includes buccal, which is in the cheeks. We'll talk about that a little bit more. Sublingual, under the tongue, oral, and rectal. Okay. All of those go under GI. Okay. Parenteral. I don't know what these are. These are the shots. Okay, these are injections of some kind. Okay? Whether it's intradermal, intramuscular, subcutaneous, intravenous. And we're going to talk about each of these in much more detail, so that's why I'm going over these kind of quick right now. Okay? Inhalation, nasal, ophthalmic, so it goes in the eye. Otic goes in the ear. Topic, transdermal, vaginal. All right, so the GI route, this is the most common route. This is also the slowest of the routes. Okay, but it is less invasive and is tolerated well by most people. Okay, literally starts at the beginning and goes all the way to the end. Okay. So the buccal, that's in the cheek. Okay, this is great for applying medication to the mouth and throat to ease inflammation. So think of sore throat, cough drops. Okay, cough drops are supposed to, you know, have them stay in, you know, over by your cheek while they're still good. You're not supposed to just chomp down on them. Okay. Anybody ever had the Luden's cherry cough drops growing up? Came in like a little box about this big. Okay, well, guess what? You probably have all had them, but they're like freaking crack candy, okay? My sister and I would be like, oh, we have a sore throat, Mom, we have a sore throat. Oh, my throat. Yeah, we would just eat that like candy. So that's not what you're supposed to do. You're actually supposed to let it stay in contact with your cheek as long as possible, okay? Because in the example of throat loss, I'm just sore throat, cough drop, something like that, okay? All of those, there's tons of mucous membranes all in your mouth, okay? This is why they use the buccal way of doing it. It gets into your system quicker than if you were to swallow, okay? Sublingual, under the tongue, okay? We have a ton of capillaries, little bitty veins, under the tongue, which provides quick absorption, okay? It's slower than injection into the vein, but it's really, really quick, okay? So example, nitroglycerin. If someone is having a possible heart attack, one of the things that they will do, if a person already has a history of heart problems, they may have nitroglycerin pills, okay? And what they'll do is they'll literally stick it under their tongue and it'll dissolve, and then in some cases it'll really help. They also have nitro spray. Typically ambulances have that. If they think that someone is having a heart attack, they're gonna spray right under the tongue. That should hopefully stop the majority of the damage, okay? Very, very quick way of getting your medication into the body. Okay, oral, so swallowing, okay? Typically, this is easiest for the patient, okay? But again, it has to go through the digestive system to get absorbed, okay? So it takes a little bit longer. Different forms of pills, oh, there's many. Okay, capsules, these are the ones that, you know, think of, well, the ones that look like capsules, sorry. Not real awake today. Okay, sometimes they can be pulled apart and you can actually mix the drug inside the food. Okay, moms will typically do that with little kids because maybe little kids can't swallow a pill yet. But mix it in there, mix it in some applesauce or whatever favorite food somebody will eat. Okay, if they're time release medication, you don't want to do that because all of a sudden where something was supposed to last for about 6, 12, 8 hours, whatever it is, it's now all getting in there at one time. Not a good idea. Okay, elixirs. They contain alcohol in preparation, so it's used a lot less often nowadays. It used to be the best thing. So think of Wild West, you know, old school taverns, loons, all that fun stuff. Elixirs were part of what they would use all the time, okay? And everybody thought that they were great because they had alcohol in them. So how much did they actually work? Okay, we don't use them as much today because of the effects of alcohol and potential for interaction. And we've come up with a lot better systems of delivery since then. Okay, emulsions. So this is a liquid drug preparation, okay, with oils and fats and water. Okay, so think of milk and magnesia. Okay. Suspensions, this is medication in liquid form. Think of Pepto-Bismol. Okay. These have to be shaken. Okay. If you've ever not had to use your Pepto for a little while and it's in the little container and then you go and you look at it, it's real dark pink on the bottom and a little lighter pink on the top. That's why you gotta shake these. It's a suspension. Because all the heavy stuff goes down the bottom. And then tablets. This is the most popular form of medication that we talked about. Okay, these can be cut in half to make it easier on the patient, especially depending on the size of pill that you're talking about. Some pills obviously are quite large, and maybe somebody can't take that large pill. Okay, the rectal route, directly into the rectum. Kind of says it in the name there. Okay, necessary with severe nausea or vomiting. Why would it be necessary for severe nausea or vomiting?
Because it gets to your stomach.
Yep. Because more than likely, if you're dealing with someone who is vomiting every 2 seconds, that medication is not getting down into their digestive system to actually be digested enough to actually work. Okay? So sometimes we get to deal with this. Enemas, these are liquids that encourage bowel movement. Oh yeah, lots of fun. Suppositories. These are medications in a waxy substance. They melt at body temperature. Okay. Typically, you're seeing this with little kids sometimes. Okay. And also those with severe vomiting. You might also see it with elderly people as well. Tends not to happen as much in typically healthy groups. Okay. Parenteral route, okay, these are given by a route other than the digestive system. Typically, like I said, these are injected, okay. We're gonna talk about intradermal, intramuscular, subcutaneous, and IV. So intradermal, or IV, the medication stays mostly in the dermis of the skin, okay. This is used for allergy testing quite a bit. And it will also check for exposure to tuberculosis, okay? This is actually how they do the tuberculosis test, so it's literally right underneath the skin, okay? And then they draw a little circle around it to make sure that there's no redness or swelling or any of that kind of stuff, okay? That's kind of what it ends up looking like right after an injection. Some devices for hormones, especially contraceptive hormones, can be implanted in this route as well, okay? So they're very close to the skin, but they're very close to the top of the skin, but they can't get out. All right, obviously somebody's having a great day too. All right, intramuscular, okay? These are all the fun ones that we probably have all had. Think of your vaccines that you ever had as a kid, okay? Or a tetanus booster, or anything like that, flu shots. These are all intramuscular route medications, okay? Typically, they're either in the deltoid, so up here in the shoulder, in the glutes, maybe into the thigh as well, okay? So they're going into the muscle. Ooh, my bad. Sorry, like I said. Medication quickly absorbed into the bloodstream because there's a ton of blood supply to the muscles. Okay, typically the drugs act within about 10 to 15 minutes. If you're having to do long-term injections, you have to rotate sites to avoid damage, okay? This, and one of the ways that I think of this on the sites for the avoiding long-term damage is someone who is taking anabolic steroids and they are injecting it, Okay, if they sit there and they keep injecting it into one muscle or one site over and over and over, ironically, the musculature will atrophy. Okay, and they'll have long-term damage. If you've ever dealt with somebody who's a steroid user and they're a long-term steroid user, this will sometimes happen just because there's only so many places that most people can get to. Okay, subcutaneous. So this is medication absorbed slowly over time because it goes into the fat. Okay, fat has a low blood supply, so typically it takes a while to get out, which is great. Okay, insulin is most commonly given this way because if you're trying to take an insulin pill, it's destroyed in the GI tract. So for those that are type 1 diabetic or type 2 diabetic and require insulin shots, typically it's in the stomach, abdomen area, okay? Because obviously there's subcutaneous fat there for the vast majority of us, maybe not so many other skinny people, but you know, the vast majority of us, there's some subcutaneous fat there. Heparin and other blood thinners can also be given this way, okay? Site rotation is very important with these to promote absorption and avoid nodule development. So same thing, if you've got someone who's a type 1 diabetic, if they sit here and they always use this one spot, there's going to become, scar tissue is going to be put into place there. It's not going to work as well. Absorption is probably not going to be as well. So they got to be a human pink cushion, which is not very much fun.
So wait, why do they do it right there?
For most of the time with the abdomen and the blood thinners, is because there's obviously usually subcutaneous fat right along the abdomen. So that's one of the easiest places to work with.
And that's like if they're diabetics?
Mm-hmm. And some diabetics will also, a lot of them it's mostly around the abdomen, but it can also be on thighs as well. Kind of depends on the people. So intravenous IV, okay, this is your fastest way to get your medication into your bloodstream. It has immediate absorption and availability, however, it's also the most dangerous because it's immediate, okay? If there's an error, there's not very much time to catch that error or reverse that error. So that could be quite deadly if possible, okay? A drip or an infusion, okay? This is a large volume of the medication in fluid administered over time. So think of whenever, if you've ever seen somebody get an IV bag, okay? Bag's about this big, so, say or so, okay? The medication that maybe they put in there is maybe this much, okay? But it's distributed throughout that whole body of fluid and it goes in via drip, so it's there, that's why they call it that, okay? Piggyback, this is a small amount of med given at very specific time intervals. So in some cases this can be pain medication, anti-nausea medication as well, we use in the piggyback forms. IV push, this is a small amount of drug injected directly into the IV line. Okay, there is very high potential for harm on this because it is literally going directly into the vein. Okay, there's not much time to catch any errors on. So this is one of those reasons why whenever we talk about the rights of the patient, okay, the right drug, the right route, right times, things like that.
The other ones don't flow directly to the vein?
The other ones do, they just take a little bit longer. Like, instead of it being almost instantaneous, it takes like 3 seconds. So, you know, if a nurse or a doctor, typically a nurse is the one that's giving the drugs, if they do a drip or an infusion, they've got a lot longer to correct that error versus the IV push. The IV push is going literally directly into the vein. Okay. All right, so do's and don'ts with intravenous routes. Okay. You will need to know some of these for your test, by the way. The complications, I can already tell you, that will be one of your short answers. So, be prepared. Okay, so do's and don'ts, you want to use the non-dominant arm most of the time if possible. Okay, because how many of us have ever, if you're, whatever dominant arm you are, if you're right or left-handed, if they've ever put an IV in that arm and then you try to reach for something because you're used to doing everything with your dominant arm, all of a sudden you have an IV in there, you can't really do much. Okay? That's just kind of annoying. Okay? Use a non-injured arm. Yeah.
So it's just the opposite of like someone's strong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if you're right-handed, most people, you want to do an IV in your left arm. Okay? Because typically, this is not the hand that you're reaching for most things for. You're not trying to do other things with that hand as much. Okay? Now, however, if you're a person like me, who unfortunately, in my antecubital region here, okay, I have like one good vein over here. This is my vein. This is the one that gets all the blood drawn. If I do blood donation, it all comes out of this guy right here. Okay? So me, I don't really have that many options as to which vein they're probably going to use if they're going to do the veins in this region. Okay? Preferably, you want to do the non-dominant arm. Use a non-injured arm. Okay? If this, okay, say that you're non-dominant arm, so for me, that would be my left. Saying that I have good veins over here. I don't, unfortunately. But if this one has an infection in it, okay, I'm not going to try and use this one for an IV most of the time. Okay? It's just not going to be what they tend to use. Now, if you've injured both arms, obviously they're going to take whichever one is in better shape in that case. Okay? Hand is typically preferred site of insertion, so usually it's about here. Okay?
And why did they do that one?
For one thing, it's really easy to find most of the time, and also it still allows movement. But it depends on what kind. It depends on what kind of medication you're giving. It also depends on what kind of condition you're dealing with. So sometimes they might not be able to. They can't use the hand. But if you're just going to do a quick. Like you've got heat cramps or something, you need to go and get IV solution in the ER to get rehydrated. Typically they'll use the hand or maybe even the wrist because it's not as invasive and not as inconvenient as in the antecubital region. Okay. You don't want to use a swollen arm, okay, because typically that means something's not working very well. Not able to deal with swelling very well, so it's probably not going to be as effective to get the medication to the rest of the body. We don't use an arm affected by a stroke. Don't use an arm on the same side as a mastectomy. Again, same reason as the swollen arm. Probably there's something happened if you are dealing with someone who was affected by a stroke or had a mastectomy. Especially with mastectomies, typically they have to take out lymph nodes with mastectomies. And so you don't want to use that arm if possible because the lymphatic system's already messed up from having to have the lymph nodes taken out. Okay? If you're dealing with someone who has a double mastectomy, again, they pick whichever arm is the better out of those two. Okay?
So the better arm is just because of the flow of lymph?
Mm-hmm. Yep. So healthier arm, you get better flow up into the rest of the body. Something that's swollen, affected by stroke, mastectomy, things like that, all of those have complications to get the IV medication into the rest of your body really well. Okay? So complications of IV therapy, probably all of us, if you've ever had an IV, will have had some of these. Okay? Bleeding, they are sticking a vein, so that kind of makes sense. Sometimes you're going to bleed from that. If the needles and things like that aren't taken care of properly, infection is a possibility. Vein irritation, that's usually pretty much going to happen. Okay, just because most of our veins are not sitting there going, hey, I want a needle in me. Okay, yours do, well, good for you, I guess. Hematoma, bruising, okay. Thrombosis. So that what that means is there's typically it's a clot. Blood clot is possible. And in some cases they can decide to move through the rest of the body. Not good. Okay? You can have nerve, tendon, ligament damage, systemic infection, air embolism. So typically there's a air bubble. That's why if you ever watch medical shows, you know how they always, and they hold